Hey folks, this is Ranker with a Diablo 3 patch 2.6.1 Season 13 video guide on the best builds. We'll take a look at the 10 best builds that you can run in Season 13 for solo Greater Rift pushing. We'll also revisit our tier list from Season 12 that groups and sorts builds for all classes according to their relative strengths. Now, Season 12 brought some sweeping changes that force a lot of estimates and speculations going into our previous tier list video. Now, we have a clearer picture of the true potential of these builds. And while most performed to expectations, there were a couple surprises. And one surprise was that I did not expect to see Season 12 have higher clears than Season 11. But it turns out that Season 12 has had the highest clears yet. Mostly thanks to one build that pushed way beyond my expectations. Now, if all you came here to see was the top 10 best builds, then you can skip ahead to the time indicated above. But I encourage you to watch the entire tier list analysis. We'll briefly cover about 40 builds, each of which is viable for endgame. In the description below, you'll find a link to either a video guide or a D3 planner link showing the best skills and gear that you want for each build. Now let's start by looking at our previous tier list, the updated list that we made after Season 12 was underway. You can see that Season 12 saw either the emergence or the rise of dozens of builds, with a gradual fading of the unbuffed Legacy of Nightmares or LON builds as power creep began to phase them out of existence. Season 12 was a breath of fresh air after a Necromancer-dominated Season 11, in which there really only was one build to rule them all, far surpassing any other. For Season 13, we are back to having a single build in the S tier, but it is only slightly ahead of the A tier builds. It was a difficult decision to have this build in its own tier, but while it may not be terribly ahead, it is distinctly ahead. The situation is nowhere near as bad as Season 11 though, and overall, the divisions between the tiers are very blurry. Now, before we dive into the tier list, we'll start by mentioning the 5 builds from Season 12 that have been dropped from this season's list. We're talking about the Monk's Legacy of Nightmares Lashing Tailkick build, the Crusader's Legacy of Nightmares Bombardment build, the Demon Hunter's Legacy of Nightmares Fan of Knives build, the Monk's Inna Exploding Palm build, and the Monk's Inna Uliana build. The Legacy of Nightmares builds are being dropped because they simply no longer meet the Tier F criteria of being 15 Greater Rifts behind S tier. Power creep has raised the highest tier achievable, and that power creep did not carry any of these LON builds. In the case of the two Inna builds, it's a mixture of falling behind the power curve, as well as simply being inferior versions of the Uliana Exploding Palm build. So that moves us into our actual tier list, starting with F tier. F as in feeling lonely. Because there are only 3 builds in this tier, and that's a good thing. The fewer builds in F tier, the more in higher tiers. Now, as a reminder, every build on this list is endgame viable. These builds are not bad, but there are plenty of stronger builds, so only go for these in F tier if you enjoy the gameplay and or don't have current access to other builds. Starting with the Monk's Raiment Duo Generator build. This was once the strongest Monk build, and it's no weaker than it used to be. It's simple power creep that has sent it down 2 tiers, and you'll note as we go along here that this is the common theme of this season's tier list. Because we now have a single build in S tier that has pushed down every other build 1 tier. That just has to do with the formatting of the list, so 1 tier downward is not an indication that the build is doing worse. As for builds that have been pushed down 2 tiers, that's because they've shown no capacity to push beyond their Season 12 expectations. So you're going to see a mixture of builds that dropped 2 tiers and only 1 tier, and these 1 tier drop builds did slightly exceed the conservative estimates that we had placed. So overall, the drops we're seeing here are not at all unexpected. Next on our list, we have the Zunimasa pet build for the Witch Doctor. While still a strong build, the Zunimasa set appears to be the weakest set for Witch Doctors. That said, Witch Doctor expert Big Daddy Den swears by this build, and I'm sure he believes that it should be placed higher on the tier list. So feel free to go check out his channel for a Zunimasa build guide. Then lastly, in the F tier, we have the Inarius Necromancer. The Necromancer starter set for Season 13, Inarius is the weakest of the 4 Necromancer sets. But if you're looking for an Inarius build guide, then you can visit Bloodshed's channel. That takes us into the D tier. D as in, don't expect to push the leaderboards with these builds. These are all capable builds, but every class has a stronger build than what is available in the D tier. Starting with the Monk's Sun Wuko Lashing Tailkick build. This build only dropped one tier because, again, it performed slightly above our Season 12 expectations. And you might be tempted to run with this because Sun Wuko is the starter set for the Monk. However, there is a Sun Wuko build that far outclasses the Lashing Tailkick that we'll get to in a little bit. Next, we have the Invoker build for Crusader. Invoker is the starter set for Season 13, and this build is more than capable of achieving every seasonal objective, and it's likely the easiest Crusader build to run. It can be built extremely tanky, and Bloodshed has a starter build guide for Invoker. Next, we have the Heaven's Fury Crusader. This is the first Akan set-based Crusader build on our list, and its greatest strength seems to be as a Rift Guardian killer in 4-man groups. And while it could also perform well solo, it is far outclassed by other Crusader Akan builds. Next we have, for the Witch Doctor, Legacy of Nightmares, Spirit Barrage. This is the only Legacy of Nightmares build left on our tier list, and it was the top Witch Doctor build of Season 11. Now the Witch Doctor has multiple stronger options that are easier to gear for. Our next three are Firebird Archon, Veer Archon, and Talrasha Veer Archon. Archons dominated the Wizard leaderboards for far too long, and there are much more powerful builds for Wizard that now exist that don't rely on Archon. But if you do want to run an Archon Wizard, then all three of these builds are roughly equal in power. Firebird Archon relies on the tricky Firebird mechanic of keeping a burning elite with you at all times to maintain your damage and toughness buffs. The Talrasha Veer Archon is the Lightning Archon that was formerly the best Wizard build, combining 6 pieces of Talrasha with 4 pieces of Veers. And Straight Veers is the closest to a true Archon Wizard, and is likely the easiest to play of the three, while also being far tankier than Talrasha Veer. Lastly, in the D tier for the Witch Doctor, we have the Helltooth Gargantuan build. The Helltooth set can push higher than this with a different build that we'll mention later in the video, but this is probably the easiest, most powerful pet build in the game. That takes us into the C tier. C as in, see these builds? They represent the average strength of these top builds. At the very bottom of the C tier, we have the Crusader Hammerdin build, which is just another casualty of power creep. Once a very high tier build, the Hammerdin is just outclassed now by other Crusader builds in terms of damage output, survivability, and just ease of play. Next, we have the Demon Hunter Unhallowed Essence Grenades build. Once the top Demon Hunter build, the Generator Grenade variant of Unhallowed Essence is now just outclassed by the Multishot variant. It's slower, it's more difficult to gear for. There's little reason to opt for UE grenades over UE multishot. Next, we have the Witch Doctor Jade Harvester build, which may not be the most powerful Witch Doctor build, but it's the one that I find most fun to play. It combines some unique mechanics with good survivability, and it's the starter set for Season 13. You can check out our build guide on how to run a Jade Doc. Next comes the Demon Hunter Shadow Impale build. The Shadow set will be the Demon Hunter starter set for Season 13, and it's possibly the best starter set of them all. Gearing up a Shadow Demon Hunter is very easy relative to other builds, because you can easily upgrade a yellow dagger in the cube to get the weapon you need. At the start of a season, you tend to see Demon Hunter players pushing with a Shadow build for this reason. It's very strong and can help you get an early head start. It does, however, fall slightly behind other Demon Hunter builds with regards to raw power. But the great thing about the Demon Hunter is that it has the greatest number of viable builds of roughly equal power. You can check out our Shadow Impale build guide. Next, we have the Leapquake Barbarian, which has performed a little bit above expectations in Season 12, allowing it to not drop any tiers. Still the weakest of the Barbarian sets, Might of the Earth does earn a respectable spot on this tier list. And it's the Barbarian starter set for Season 13. Feel free to check out our build guide. Next, we have the Roland Crusader Sweep build. It dropped only one tier because it performed slightly above expectations. And while it could likely push higher, it's not a build that many Crusader players are eager to push with. Partly because it just can't reach the raw damage potential of the strongest Crusader build, and partly because it's relatively weak in terms of survivability. That takes us to the Captain America Crusader build, which is another Crusader build that players aren't eager to push with. It can't reach the same damage output as the strongest Crusader build. And since both Captain America and the strongest Crusader build are both based on the Akan set, there's little reason to opt for Captain America unless you just really enjoy the playstyle. And if you want want to toss your shield around, we got a build guide for that. Next, we have the Talrasha Channeling Meteor Wizard. This is one variant of the Meteor Wizard, and it is easier to run, but a bit weaker. That said, for many players, that's enough to justify running this over the stronger but trickier variant. Next, we have the Witch Doctor's Helltooth Firebats build, which unlocks the true potential of the Helltooth set. Pets could only get you so far. Firebats is the Witch Doctor's greatest damage spell, and there are two sets that can be built around Firebats. Helltooth is the weaker variant, but is arguably easier to run. And that leaves us with just one Witch Doctor build left on this list. Next, we have the Demon Hunter's Natalia set. It's strong enough in its own right, and again, all the Demon Hunter builds that we're covering here are pretty close in power, but Natalia's true potential really unlocks when you combine it with another set. We'll cover that variant in the next tier. Lastly, in the C tier, we have the Barbarian's Immortal King Hammer of the Ancients build. This build is incredibly strong for how easy it is to play, and it could likely push even higher if not for the fact that there is a more powerful variant of this build. That takes us to our B tier. B as in... bet you're not going to use these builds, because you're probably just going to skip to the A tier builds. We kick off this tier with the Monk's Uliana build. It's a very strong build, and when you're able to execute it well, it's really satisfying to play. But it is a very tricky build to play correctly. And there is one stronger Monk build that exists that basically everyone plays, because it's so much easier to run. Next, we have the Demon Hunter's Marauder build, which doesn't drop a tier because it performed above expectations this season. And we're now into the top three Demon Hunter builds, which are all B tier. We'll talk about Marauders alongside the next build on our list, N6M4, which combines 6 pieces of Natalia's with 4 pieces of Marauders. Both are roughly equally powerful when you factor in damage multipliers and playstyle, but N6M4 has far more toughness. With the Marauder build, particularly with the grenade variant that we're showing, which is the strongest Marauder build, you need to set out 5 sentries in order to gain your full damage buff. The sentries don't deal any appreciable damage themselves, they're just there to buff you. With N6M4, it's the other way around. You're buffing your sentries' damage. That means that in order for you to deal your max damage, you need to ensure that you have all your sentries out and that they're all able to strike the target that you are firing at. With every sentry you have that is not hitting your target, you are dealing a considerable fraction of your optimum damage. Next in the B tier, we have the Rathma Necromancer. This is the strongest non-pestilence necromancer build. And necromancers are always integral parts of the 4-man speed meta. While capable of tremendous damage per second, the inability to direct your mages is perhaps this build's greatest weakness. Next, we have our final Demon Hunter build, the Multi-Shot Unhallowed Essence Demon Hunter. Whether this is truly the strongest Demon Hunter build is up for debate. Again, we have multiple Demon Hunter builds of roughly equal power, and this puts the Demon Hunter in an excellent state. Yes, they don't have any A-tier builds, but at least they offer the most variety of builds, and B certainly isn't garbage tier. You can check out our multi-shot guide over here. Next, we have the Whirlwind Barbarian. Whirlwind has been a Barbarian staple since Diablo 2, and while it's a little tricky to gear a Whirlwind Barbarian to push as far as you can, it's a very powerful build, and we have a guide for it. Next, we have the final Witch Doctor build on this list. The Arakir Firebats Witch Doctor. This glass cannon build is the king of area damage, and it serves a solid role as an area damage dealer in 4-man groups. Alright, now we move into our top 10 builds. Starting with number 10, the DMO Frozen Orb Wizard. That's the Delzaire's Magnum Opus set. There's basically 3 types of viable endgame builds for Wizard. Archon Wizards, Frozen Orb Wizards, and Meteor Wizards. On console, you have the Twister Wizard Reign Supreme, but Twisters were nerfed on PC a long time ago. DMO was looking to be the set that can pull off the strongest Frozen Orb Wizard build, until a new build emerged during Season 12. But you may not like the playstyle of that one, so if you want to rock a DMO Frozen Orb Wizard, you can check out our build guide. And that brings us into our A-tier builds. A-tier as in... yeah. These are basically the best builds in the game, along with our S-tier build. Coming in at number 9, we have the Sunwuko Wave of Light Monk. This is the best Monk build in the game, and it can be easily adapted into a speed build. With Sunwuko being the starter set for Season 13, Monk is a strong pick for this season. We have a Wave of Light build guide over here. Coming in at number 8, we have the Firebird Channeling Meteor Wizard. Firebird's meteor is stronger than Tal's meteor, but again, it relies on that Firebird mechanic whereby you wanna always drag along with you a burning elite in order to maintain your full damage and toughness buffs. Feel free to check out our Firebird Channeling Meteor build guide. On to number 7, we have the Veer Frozen Orb Wizard. This build emerged during Season 12 as a stronger variant of the DMO Frozen Orb Wizard, and it's sort of a reverse Archon build. Yes, it's an Archon build, but you're just using Archon to build up buff stacks, which you then benefit from while out of Archon. So normally in an Archon build, you're doing all your damage in Archon. In this variant, you're doing no damage in Archon. You're doing all your damage out of Archon while you're throwing your frozen orbs. Coming in at number 6, we have the Hammer of the Ancients Raykor Barbarian build. This build has not dropped a tier because it performed above expectations. This proved to be the stronger variant of the Hota Barbarians, but it is also more challenging to play than the Immortal King version. And the playstyle of Raykor, particularly when mixed with the Hota skill, doesn't appeal to everyone. And that takes us to number 5, our final Barbarian build, the Charge Barb. Again, this is one of the most challenging builds to play to its maximum potential, and there's no shame in wanting to opt for something a little easier. The Barbarian has some solid alternatives, which you've outlined, and you'd likely push higher with a slightly weaker build that you can execute better than with a Charge Barb if you don't have great execution. That said, if you're up for the challenge, we have a build guide on getting you started on your path to mastering the Charge Barb. That takes us to number 4, the Tragul Corpse Lance Necromancer. In Season 11, this was by far the strongest build in the game, and it's no weaker today. We'll also reveal number 3 as a Pestilence Corpse Lance build, because these two builds are extremely similar, with the main difference just being which set you're using. The Cold Pestilence variant is capable of higher damage output, but the Tragul variant has greater survivability, so they both come out to be basically just as strong. We have build guides for the Tragul version, as well as for the Pestilence version. That takes us to number 2, the Star-Packed Firebird Meteor Wizard. This variant of the Firebird Meteor build uses the Arcane Star Pact rune rather than the Fire rune on Meteor. It is technically the strongest wizard build in the game, and it is technically almost S-tier worthy. However, it loses points because in order to reach its maximum potential, it requires players to execute perfectly timed key presses at regular intervals throughout the entire rift. And in fact, many of the top clears with this build use macros to perfectly execute all those timings. Now, you're not allowed to use macros in Diablo 3. Don't do it, you can get banned. But the reason I'm keeping this build where it is because it is theoretically possible to pull off those timings if you are some kind of godlike player. For most players, however, you're better off sticking with the Fire variant. And if you want a full technical explanation on why that is, I encourage you to visit SVR90's stream. That takes us to number 1, the best solo Greater Rift pushing in the entire game, the Condemn Crusader. While this build is not ridiculously overpowered, after much internal debate, I resolved to put it in a tier of its own because it is strong enough to be just slightly considered above the others. It's by far the most popular build to push with for Crusaders. It's not super challenging to run, it's a fun build. It has a great speed variant, which we've covered in this video here, along with the pushing variant. And I think one key factor that keeps it from being too overpowered is that the Crusader does not have a strong role in groups. So while yes, the Crusader may have the best solo Greater Rift pushing build, it does not have the best build for multiplayer. And that's going to wrap up this video. As a reminder, we have links in the description below to guides on all these builds, or at the very least, D3 Planner links to all the skills and gear that you need. Thanks for watching. Special thanks to my Twitch and Patreon supporters for making these videos possible. If you like what you see on this channel and want to support the creation of more content, you can pledge on Patreon, where we have a variety of backer rewards, where I often put up the tier list ahead of time while I'm still working on it. I put up kind of work in progress stuff on Patreon, and all support is immensely appreciated. If you enjoyed this video, please share it, check out these other videos, and subscribe to join Rikers Raiders for more Diablo content.